Does the Pope have the keys to the kingdom? No way. Let's look at that subject. This abundance of artwork showing Jesus giving Peter the keys to the kingdom with the assumption that he passed them down and that modern-day popes are descendants of that lineage and that the Roman Catholic Church possesses solely by themselves the keys to the kingdom. This is an emblem of the papacy used by the Catholic Church. It's an official emblem. Notice the two keys crossed right there. In fact, the entire concept of Catholicism is based on this false concept that Jesus designated to the apostles, Peter in particular, the unique ability to have to be the mediator between God and man. Wow, this is primitive, crazy theology. Now we're going to go to the inspired, preserved words of God, King James Version, see what he has to say. And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Now the Protestants go into a lot of manipulation of the text, pointing out the difference in the Greek words for rock and upon this rock and thou art rock and two different rocks, a little rock, big rock, that sort of thing, and try to point out that Jesus gave the keys of the kingdom to all the apostles and not just to Peter. And so it's been this lifelong historical struggle between those two concepts. And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven. There it is again, kingdom of heaven. And whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Now those of you who've been following me know already that the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven are not the same thing. Quite a bit different. He didn't give him the keys to the kingdom of God. He gave them the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Now that would be a big bummer because right now there is no kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of heaven is possessed by Satan right now and by people like Putin and Joe Biden and the Ayatollahs and Hamas. Those are the ones who possess the kingdom right now because they took it by force. So if you have the keys to the kingdom now, it won't get you into heaven. Let's read further. In Isaiah 22, the scriptures say, and the key of the house of David will I lay upon his shoulder, so shall he open, and none shall shut. He shall shut, and none shall open. Now that passage is quoted in the New Testament in line with this subject. So he gives unto him, and that's that's the Lord Jesus Christ, the keys to the house of David, and he will open, and no man will shut. He will shut, and no man will open. So that's his and his alone. Now, why Peter? Why did he give Peter the keys to the kingdom of heaven, not kingdom of God? And we read, and when he had said this, he breathed on them and saith unto them, receive ye the Holy Ghost. This is all the apostles. And whosoever sins ye remit, they are remitted unto them, and whosoever sins you retain, they are retained. So that's based on that former passage. So when he gave them the keys to the kingdom, here in Acts chapter 1, Peter is going to exercise that key to the kingdom of heaven. He's going to open it up to the whole world, to the Jews right here at this particular time. And he's going to bind and loose. He's going to allow into the kingdom not only Jews, but in time Gentiles as well. You need to listen to that phrase again. So whosoever sins you remit, they're remitted unto them. Whosoever sins you retain, they're retained. Now the Roman Catholic Church teaches that Jesus gave the Pope and his descendants the keys to the kingdom so that they have the power to forgive sins or to not forgive sins. Thus, the Catholic Church used that throughout the Dark Ages and beyond to manipulate their congregants and kings by threatening to withhold their salvation and by people coming to the so-called sacrament to to receive their forgiveness and salvation, and going to confession so the pope, a priest, could remit their sins. That's primitive, weird theology, and there's a few people who still believe it. Most people who practice it don't really believe it. But ye shall receive power, Jesus said, after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. And then we read, and Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, for the promise is unto you, to your children, and here's the whosoever sins you remit, going beyond to all that are far off, to as many as the Lord our God shall call. So even the Gentiles would be included in this. And with many words did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this untoward generation. And they that gladly received his word were baptized, and that same day there was added unto them about 3,000 souls. So in one day, Peter uses the keys to bring in 3,000 souls into the kingdom of heaven. Now, they also entered the kingdom of God. But at this point, God is still offering the kingdom of heaven to the Jewish nation. And he does probably up through Acts 7. In other words, if they had repented as a nation and believed, the kingdom of heaven would have been instituted at that time. And the angel of the church of Philadelphia write, these things saith he that is holy, he that is true, he that hath the key of David, he that openeth and no man shutteth, shutteth and no man openeth. That comes out of Isaiah there. So Jesus was given the key to open and shut. No man has that power to let a soul in or keep a soul out except through the preaching of the gospel. And the scribes and the Pharisees began to reason, saying, who is this which speaketh blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God alone? So even the Pharisees knew that there was only one way to get forgiven, and that was through God. But that ye may know that the Son of Man hath power upon earth to forgive sins, he saith unto thee, arise, take up thy couch, and go into thy house. So only the Son of Man has power upon earth to forgive sins. The very concept that a fornicating pope has the power to forgive my sins, that I have to go to him or through some system that's instituted, an institutionalized Christianity, that I can't go directly to God. I have to go through these man-made sacraments. I have to go through these man-made confessions. I have to have holy water sprinkled and words said over me and all of this so that salvation becoming a faithful member of a club that's corrupt. Did you know that even today, many, many Catholic priests and cardinals denounce the present pope as Antichrist? Just look it up. They're calling him the Antichrist. How could he be the one having the keys to the kingdom of God if he is an Antichrist? So Jesus deinstitutionalized access to God. You remember when he went to the woman at the well and she said, we know which place is the best place to worship, here on this mountain or there in Jerusalem. Our fathers say here on this mountain, your people say Jerusalem. Which is it? Jesus said, I'm telling you, the hour has come and now is when the true worshipers of God must worship him in spirit and in truth. Fishermen don't have it wrong when they say that the lake is their cathedral. You get on a lake early in the morning with the fish biting and you know you're in God's presence. You get in the woods hunting and quiet and still, you know you're in God's presence. You get out in your own garden, start pulling weeds out, taking a little bite of a strawberry here and there and pull up a radish and eat it. You know you're in God's presence. That's God's. You can walk out in the middle of the night, look up at the stars. You go into a church, and that's one of the most difficult places to find God's presence these days. It's so full of flesh, so full of carnality, so full of false doctrine that it'd be difficult to find God there. I sympathize with a sinner saying, if those are Christians, I don't want to be one. Now, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into his grace, wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. So you see, We're not justified by what we do. We're not justified by what we belong to. We're not justified by what somebody else says about us or says over us or does to us. We're not justified by water baptism. We're not justified by receiving the Holy Ghost with speaking in tongues. We're justified by faith, not in anyone but the Lord Jesus Christ. And we have peace with God, and then we have access by faith into His grace. See, I have access all the time, everywhere that I am, at any moment. I can speak directly to God, and He hears me. And any religion that tries to funnel you through their system is a lying fraud. So, those of you that have resisted God because of religion, I sympathize with you. People say there's hypocrites in the church. You don't know the half of it. There's some that are not. That's the best way to look at it. There's some that are not. But you don't need to be one of them. So you can know God right where you are without going to any church. You can begin to worship God right where you are. You can take your Bible and begin to read it. You can celebrate your finished work in Christ. And then you can find yourself a group of Christians inside a church building or outside a church building or on a riverside. And you can begin to worship God with them. So that's going to be all for today. By the way, these spots all over me, I have learned a new art. I can move heavy objects with my face. All right, that's all for today.